Hey everyone, so this video tutorial is going to be going over how I took the Oliver and S fairy tale dress and I kind of made it my own, so it's not going according to the directions. Not that I am saying anything wrong about the directions, I actually found them to be quite clear and well done. I'm just doing things differently because it's sewing, so you do you. So this is going along with a kit that I have available on my website. Of course, you can take this tutorial and use it for whatever you would, however you find it helpful, but that's my intent, is for it to have it be an accompanying a kit that I have available. So the kit that I have comes with, you know, the pattern, the fabric, the thread, the whole embroidery motif that you see, the floche that you need, the zipper, everything that you need for this dress. But I will say that the zipper, just in full honesty, does not match the green of the dress. I did the best I could, and with COVID times, things are out of stock. And so I actually ordered online two different greens, and this is the best match from the stuff that is in stock. Just an FYI. I will say that we're going to be inserting this as a lap zipper, so really you aren't going to be seeing the zipper, and it's not that big of a deal because it's going to be a lap zipper, which I will explain. So to start, you can pre-wash your fabric if you want to, and I'm making this dress differently than what the pattern calls for, as I mentioned earlier. So I cut out two bodice pieces on the fold, four collar pieces, and four back pieces. These back pieces are not going to be cut on the fold, as well as one set of skirt pieces. And I do have a layout that's included in the kit, like an updated layout that shows how I'm differing it from what the pattern calls for. Also, you may want to trace out the pattern pieces if you want to keep the original pattern intact, because the pattern, it is nested, which yes, it does suck, but you just trace it and you move on. Especially for what we're doing, all you have to do is you have to trace the bodice front and back and the collar, and then as far as the skirt's concerned, you can just measure that and use a rotary cutter or something of that sort. So then, when we get to doing the bodice construction, we have to talk about those darts. So when you do a dart, or at least an easy way to do a dart, is to put a pin at the top of the dart and then put little clip marks at the bottom of the dart. Of course, make sure those clip marks at the bottom of your dart don't go into your seam allowance. I believe the seam allowance here is half an inch, and so just do them, you know, a quarter of an inch or an eighth of an inch or something like that, and you'll be all fine. So then what you can do is you can just kind of pull that pin gently through the tissue. It'll leave a little bit of a hole, and then you can put your clips together at the bottom and pull that pin out to the side, and you will have, you know, from the pin to the clip marks, now you've got two points, makes a line, right? And you can do right side together and through your machine. Now, if you want to have like an additional layer of help, you can take a straight edge and have your fabric flat, and then from the point, top of the, you know, the two points again, from one clip mark to the pin and the other clip mark to the pin, just use a either Wally solderable pin or a heat activated pin and connect the dots. That way you have some sort of line to trace, you have a line to sew on. So you want to do this on the wrong side of the garment, since the dart goes together right sides together. Either way you go, again, right sides together, and you will send that dart through your machine. I personally like going taking darts from the bottom to the top. But either way, you want to be very gradual with this, and having that mark there, if you decided to trace it, might be very helpful to you. That way that you don't have any sharp, see, if you have any sharp, not gradual areas, then you can have a dart that doesn't lay flat. So you just want to be mindful of that. So then you can move on once you've done all those darts. There's a bunch of them. You got to do the lining, and you got to do your outside of the garment. You can move on to your shoulder seams. So I joined the shoulder seams of the front of the bodice as well as the lining using half-inch seams allowance. And there's no bodice ring method here that we're doing. We're just doing the bodice of the dress, like the good outside that you're going to see. You're going to have those three pieces, the bodice front and the two backs. And then you're going to have your lining, the bodice front and the two backs. Okay, so you're gonna have two sets of the same thing, one the lining and one the outside of the garment. So then, like I said, I join them at the shoulder seams, and then I iron those seams open. And then moving on to the collar, I sew the collar together with the lining with right sides together, again, half inch seam allowance here. And I was just careful around those curves with any collar, right? You're careful around the curves. You want to lower your stitch length to something small. That way you're able to get that curve. It's more smooth. The smaller the stitch, I mean, you don't want to go too super, super tiny that you're just stitching on top of itself, but something like a 1.5 or so is a good stitch length, 1.8, something like that is a good stitch length. That way you just have a nice gradual curve and you don't have like chamfers going around. Does that make sense? So then you can trim up the seam allowance to reduce bulk, trim off the corners of the collar, and turn things right sides out. Using a pointer tool is helpful to push everything out. So the last thing with this collar, you can iron everything at this point too. Okay, so you've got your collar all ironed down. The last thing about this collar before we move on is it is very helpful to baste your collars together. That way you don't have a gap. All right? Hold on. All right, so I've been booted to the laundry room because the littlest one is now taking a nap, so we don't have the sound machine in the background. I'm in here, and I don't want to wake her up and all this stuff. So back to our collar. We are going to take the collar, and you're going to, just to avoid a gap in the middle of the collar, it's a good thing to baste it, whether you baste it by hand or you take a wide zigzag like I'm doing and just put a couple zigzags in there and just do it wide so it's easy to remove later on. But basting it will just, it makes it very... very easy to keep the collars together so you don't get a gap in there, which is not the, it's not the worst thing, but you know, it's not as polished as it can be with no gap. So do that, and then I'm going to put the collar to the bodice, to like the outside of that bodice, the side you're going to see when the garment's being worn, and I'm going to baste the collar around. I'm going to match the center front of the collar to the center front of the garment, and I'm going to pin around and then baste it on the sewing machine around. I'm just using like a quarter inch seam allowance. Doesn't really matter, it's just something that's going to be going on the inside and holding the collar in place. That way, when you're done with that, you can take the lining of your bodice and put that down on that whole collar bodice assembly, put the, all of that right sides together. And here you're going to sew around the neckline as well as both armholes, okay? So both arms eyes, I think. How you refer to them as. Anywho, so you don't want to sew though down the side seam. So when you go around that arm circle, meaning the arm's eye, whatever, don't do the side seam there. Leave the side seams alone and only do the little circle part, oval part, whatever it is. When you're done stitching that, you can clip the curves, you know, trim off any corners, and you want to clip the curves. I should do a video on this now that I know graphic animation. If y'all have seen my how to shadow smock, not shadow smock, shadow border with my graphic animation, but you want to clip the curves to the point. The clipping the curves allows everything to open up, and so if you turn your garment right sides out and you have some kind of tight puckering, you know that you need to go back and clip some more curves. Of course, be careful you don't clip through your stitches and things of that nature, but you want to clip the curves, and the more clips, particularly if it's a tight curve, you want to do more clips so it has the ability to open up some more. So once you've clipped your curves, now you can turn your bodice right sides out. So you're going to, from the front of the bodice, you're going to reach in there and grab each side, each back of the bodice, not side, each back of the bodice. So you'll reach in, pull one back out, and then reach back in and pull the other back out. And just give everything a really, really good ironing here. Ironing is going to be your best friend, giving it a good pressing to having everything laying nice and flat. If it doesn't lay nice and flat, particularly after an ironing, you know that you need to go clip some, your curves some more, as I mentioned. So now we could take our side seams, and you're going to kind of open everything back up. And so you'll have the right side, like the bodice side that you're going to be seeing when the garment's worn. You'll open that back up, and it will go on to, half of it will be the bodice and half of it will be the lining. And you will match this back up to the other side seam. You will put them together and then stitch a half an inch seam allowance, joining the two together. So the thing about this, though, I really like this method. The thing about it is that it can leave a little bit of bulk underneath the arm where all of the, where like the seam of the two seams intersect, like the seam of the arm's eye and the seam of the now side seam. So what you can do is just take your scissors and trim that bulk out of there. Just, you know, trim her up into, you know, quarter inch, eighth of an inch or something, just underneath the arm. And then you can iron all of that down. So at this point, we are done with the bodice. You can pull those basting threads out of the collar and kind of set the bodice aside, and we can work on the skirt. So the skirt, you're going to join the pieces together at the side seams using French seams. And I have another video that dives into how to do French seams, like all the details of it, close-up shots and everything. And I'll have that link down below. And then once you're done joining your whole skirt together, you can hem up the skirt. So what I did is I just folded the hem, the raw edge of the hem up, or the raw edge, not of the hem, but the raw edge of half an inch, and then and I just eyeball half an inch. I find that's really easy to eyeball, but of course you can measure it if you want to. And then I folded it up again 2.5 inches, I believe it was 2.5 inches. And then I would to do this is I would start at one end, measure 2.5 inches, put a pin there, go over, you know, some 8-10 inches away, measure again, 2.5 inches, put a pin there, and now you have two points make a line. And so it's not, you know, it's within the tolerance of being accurate, you know, like it's not, it doesn't need to be more accurate than this is what I'm trying to say. So you can just iron down to establish like your line and get everything down in place. That way it'll be easier when it comes to stitching. So I just repeat that whole measure and pin, iron, that whole thing until I have the entire hem down. And then once I do that, you can just stitch across the hem, right? This for me is going to be like a fall, not for me, it's for my daughter. But in my mind, this is a fun play dress for the fall. So it's not something that I'm going to take hand work to the hem. Like if it was more of like a delicate, you know, fancier thing, I would stitch the hem up by hand. But then like I said, this is going to be a play thing, so I'm going to stitch it down by machine. And of course, you do you. And also in the footage you're seeing that I'm using white thread, but you do have, if you bought the kit from me, you do have green thread in your kit to match your fabric. So then I gather the top of my skirt from one center back to the other center back. So from one edge to the next edge, I'm just gathering the whole shebang, and I'm doing two rows of gather stitches, one on either side of where those permanent stitches for the waist seam is going to go later on. So I gather up threads, and I like to gather. I start at one edge, and I'll do some gathers. I'll do the other edge. I'll do some gathers, and I just continue that until the entire thing is gathered up. I find that is easy, at least for me. That's like the method I prefer, to have everything completely scrunched up, and then I start undoing it, and that allows, I don't know, it makes it easy. At least I find it's easy to have everything evenly distributed. So I will pin one end to the bodice. Of course, I'm leaving the lining out at this point, okay? So I'm taking my skirt, I'm putting it right sides together with my bodice, and I'm just going to leave the lining out at this point. We don't want to include the lining into this step. So I'm putting the skirt right sides together with that bodice, and I am putting, you know, one end, pinning one end, and then going and pinning another end, or the other end, and then I'm going to pin center front to center front. Hi, sweetie. Can I help you? Where was I? Oh, so then I pin the center front to center front, you know, of the skirt to center front of the bodice. I'm pinning the side seams to the of the skirt to the side seams of the bodice, and then I'm adjusting the gathers. Everything's evenly distributed in the correct length from there. And then, of course, sewing the two together, and I'm doing that using a half-inch seam allowance. All right, so we just sewed the skirt together with the bodice on the waist seam. We are almost there. At this point, it's sewing up the back seam and the zipper. And yes, this pattern calls for a zipper. It actually calls for a zipper that's like 20, 22 inches long, depending on what size you're making. Personally, I think that is like way long for a little girl's sizing of a dress, but to each their own. It's sewing, you do you. So I am including a 20-inch zipper. Like I said, the green is a little bit off because we're in COVID and things are out of stock, and this is the best as we can do. So we're going to do a lap zipper. The pattern also calls for an invisible zipper, and while I like the look of them, I don't like how they operate. I used to make dresses for myself, a ton of them back in the day, and I would find after, you know, 6 months to a year, the zipper would just bust, whereas the regular style, like traditional style, I don't know what you call them, the zippers, they just last, and I feel like they operate better, so I like to stick with them, and that's what's in your kit. So to shorten my zipper, I found where I wanted to shorten it, and I would just sew over it. So I'm just using straight stitches. I'm going over, back and forth a few times to basically create a new tab. And then I'm going to cut off the extra, and I'm going to leave about an inch between my new tab and where I cut off my zipper. So I'm going to leave an inch there that will go in, like on the other side of like back down into the dress, if that makes sense. So to sew up the back. So I sewed up the back wherever you decide your zipper should stop. I am sewing at the back additional inch. Does that make sense? So where the tab is on your zipper, you're going to sew an additional inch more than where the tab is on that zipper. So you'll have where the seam stops. You'll have where the tab is, and there'll be about an inch in between that, and then between where the tab is and where the actual zipper that you cut off, or where it ended from the manufacturer if you didn't cut it off, that'll be another, you know, inch and a half from there. You have those three sections. Does that make sense? Or two sections, those 3 points. So to finish this seam, you kind of have three options. You could use just pinking shears, keep it easy on yourself, and use some of those to keep it from fraying. You could do some sort of like a kind of like a Hong Kong seam where you wrap the raw edge with like you introduce a new piece of fabric, a strip of fabric, wrap it around, kind of like a bias band or something, bias binding or whatever, and wrap it around, and you could do that. Or you could foil line your dress, and the pattern actually calls to foil line your dress. I'm making this out of corduroy, that's what's included in the kit. And I just didn't see any reason to fully line it, so there is no lining for the skirt in your kit. If you want to line it, just grab some from your stash, you know, Imperial Batiste or something, and you can line your dress that way. So regardless, you just sew up the back of the dress, like I said, an inch more than where your zipper is going to end, and sew it all the way. So then you're going to iron open that seam, and I marked a half an inch away from the raw edge of the back of the dress. So the dress has like an allowance of half an inch to put in that zipper, which is why I'm marking half an inch. You may find that helpful, especially if you haven't really done zippers, or if it's been a long time since you have, like I am. So for the top of the zipper, I just fold that little tab under and I place it up. And I place it up a little bit below where the top of like the neckline is. I personally don't like a hook and eye. That's just my personal preference, so that's why I'm doing this. If you want a hook and eye, then move it down even more so you have the space for hook and eye. I just find that it's really nice if you just fold that edge under, you back down off the lining, or not the lining, you back down off the neckline a little bit, and it just comes together. I think it looks really nice. So I fold that edge under, and I also fold the edge of the lining under. Both of these are about half an inch. And I place the dress folded edge right next to the teeth of the zipper. And then I place the lining's folded edge about eighth of an inch away. And so I pin this in place and I baste with long running stitches. And it does not matter if you sew over these basting stitches, it'll come right out. It won't. Your machine stitches will be fine, so don't worry about that. But I really like to baste in a zipper before I go to the machine with it. I just think that it makes things, it lines everything up, it stops your fabric from easing, you know, stretching out this way or that way as you're sewing over it with your machine, and you don't have to deal with sewing around pins. So I really like just to baste it. Then I change my foot to a zipper foot and I sew that one length in place. I'm doing the right side of the zipper to begin with. I just go down the whole thing. Now I repeat the second side, although this time, this is the part that's going to lap over. So this time I am, same thing, I'm putting my zipper sandwiched in between the lining and the garment, you know, having both of them folded under about half an inch, but I'm placing it such that the lining is still like eighth of an inch away from the teeth on the underside, but the front, like the back of, you know, the part that's being shown on the garment when it's being worn, that's going to be overlapped. It's going to overlap so that it's about like an eighth of an inch over from the other side of the zipper. And I'm really glad I have visuals for this because I know my words are not very good. So I, again, pin that all in place, debase that in place, and this time when I'm done basting, I go to my machine and I start at the bottom of that zipper where I stopped my stitches before. So I'm putting my needle right down where I left off. I'm going over, like, not where the tab is because you don't want to break your needle or anything, but you're going, particularly if you still have a metal tab, don't go over a metal tab, you will break a needle. But I'm starting where I left off, going over the zipper, this will be above where the zipper tab is, and then I'm putting my needle down, turning my work, and continuing on to sew that whole length of zipper in. Alright, so at this point we are almost done. We can pull out our basting threads from our zipper and we have one last thing. We have to sew down the lining of the bodice. So I just folded her under because I like to save all my hand sewing for the very end before I did, you know, my zipper. And so now I can take a needle and thread. I can put my thread between where the lining is and the garment fabric is, like between those two layers, to hide my tail. And then I tie on by creating a loop. I go through that loop twice and I pull tight. And then from here, I can just take the folded edge, which is right next to, like it's folded right next to where those machine stitches are. I can go through a machine stitch into that folded edge, through a machine stitch into that folded edge, through a machine stitch to that folded edge. And that's how I sew down the lining. So I hope this is helpful. I would love to see y'all's creation for this fall kit that I've got going on. Of course, if you just stumbled upon this video because you're just making the Oliver and S fairy tale dress, I hope it was helpful. But if you did my kit, I would love to see how it turned out. And I hope you had fun making it. If you have any questions, by all means, put them down in the comments below. And I will do my best to answer them. And as always, I appreciate y'all for watching. And I hope to catch y'all next time.